Let me start the day by introducing a man who needs absolutely no introduction, Bill Gates. Welcome, Bill. The roots of today's conversation started when we last met, and we were at the TED conference, and we were talking about thorium reactors, and we'd recently written a piece about thorium as an alternative to uranium-based reactors, and I thought, you know, we were just chatting, and I thought you might be interested in this, and so I just mentioned the word thorium, and about 20 minutes later, you know, with my jaw fully on the floor, I realized that along with everything else, aside from possibly pop music and reality TV, you were encyclopedically expert on thorium reactors. And much discussion in neutronics later, I felt that I was I realized what Bill Gates post Microsoft means, which is that we have the opportunity for you and your wisdom, your incredible curiosity, and your economic leverage to enter these new industries and find ways to reinvent them. And so I thought that energy is such an important subject right now, and one that you're so engaged in that we would have an opportunity today to just kind of run through all the various energy alternatives and disruptions and get your perspective on them all. I wanted to start with nuclear. You know, you have an investment in a nuclear technology company, and I want to just ask to begin with, how has Japan changed your perspective on nuclear and your sense of what the trajectory for nuclear will be, both in the United States and the world?
Well, I'm glad we're not talking about reality TV, because I truly know nothing about that. while others are watching reality TV, I'm reading Václav Smil to try and learn something about energy. You know, the key in energy, I think, is that the status quo is pretty unacceptable. That is, in terms of security, in terms of cost, in terms of environmental impact, if we don't have innovation in energy, we don't improve much at all. Energy is fundamental to farming, transport, heating. If you can think of one advance that would change society and make it better, reducing the cost of energy would be almost the top of the list, I think. In fact, if you gave me a choice of picking the next 10 presidents or having energy be a quarter as expensive and environmentally friendly, which one could improve things better, I'd pick the energy thing. And there aren't that many ways to get energy. Nuclear is one of very few. You know, we have three types of energy factories: nuclear, natural gas, and coal. And then we have various forms of energy farming, which are about 1,000 times more diffuse per area. And that's wind, biofuels, and solar thermal, solar chemical, solar electric. So that's energy farming. And so somewhere in the, either in the energy factory or energy farming, you've got to solve cost, environmental, and security. And all of them have big problems, huge reasons why they don't immediately lend themselves to fixing those problems. Nuclear, you've got the cost of the plant, you've got the waste disposal, you've got making sure there's no proliferation, you've got safety, and you've got eventually fuel limitations if you're depending on it in a big way. The good news about nuclear is that there's hardly been any innovation in nuclear, and so the room to do things differently is quite dramatic. You start every individual reaction gives you a million times more energy than the other energy factories. That is, if you take coal and burn that, you take natural gas and burn that, per reaction you're getting a million times less. So starting with a factor of million advantage seems like a good deal. Now, unfortunately, by the time you have all these safety things and disposal things, you can give up. You might give up more than your factor of a million if you're not careful. But you won't find a reaction that's as fundamentally favorable. This Fukushima thing is terrible. It's awful for the people there. You know, there's many reasons why it should have been avoided, both in terms of the initial design. It's a 1960s design, three reactors put into service 1971, 1973, 1974. It's an early generation two type design, and the emergency plans were quite weak, and the actual execution in the situation was quite weak. The actual effect is clearly going to be very negative. Now, if you compare it to the amount that coal's killed per kilowatt hour, or natural gas, you know, blows up neighborhoods every once in a while, it's way, way less. And it tends to come in these big events, like 25 years ago, Chernobyl, 31 years ago, Three Mile Island, and now Fukushima. And so it's more visible, and it needs to be improved. Those designs, they never could simulate. They couldn't simulate what would happen. They couldn't simulate the disaster. And you know, the beauty in almost every realm that you'll talk about at this conference is that software simulation changes the game. We sit there and take... there's this funny company, TerraPower, which is a thing that Nathan Myhrvold and I have spun out of his invention group, Intellectual Ventures. And it's a new nuclear design, which on paper is quite amazing. On paper, it's a lot easier to do these things. But when I say on paper, I really mean in a supercomputer where we simulate everything. And so we can simulate Richter 10 earthquake. We simulate 70-foot waves coming into these things. Very cool. We basically say no human should ever be required to do anything, because if you judge by Chernobyl and Fukushima, the human element is not on your side. Even if all you have to do is circulate a little bit of water over something, a storage pool of spent fuel, all you have to do is keep it underwater. You don't even have to circulate. And yet, because of a variety of things, that turned out to be difficult. So you've got to design something that humans just don't have to be involved in. So it has real potential. It doesn't move at the speed of semiconductors, so the best case is that by 2020, one of these will get built. And then by 2030, you could have hundreds of them. And then, if it's really as economic as we say, and of course, it is CO2-free. That's the easiest part. Then it starts to make a big impact.
You're a technologist and inherently rational, and yet nuclear power is inherently political. This is less about the facts and more about the perception, often, just getting these things approved. When you look at sort of the path to getting these things deployed, built, the not in my backyard problem, et cetera, do you think that it's possible for a leader to overcome the political opposition to nuclear post Japan and continue on the pace of new installations that you were hoping for before?
Well, I think politicians have to deal with death of coal miners, death from particulate, death from natural gas, and yet the voters seem to want energy to drive around and heat their homes. So it's going to be a political decision, because these things are highly regulated, as they should be. And many of them require government involvement in the early stages to get the technologies going, and right-of-ways, many things that involve politics. And so you'll have to really, A, be safe, and B, be able to communicate that you are incredibly safe. The nuclear industry has this amazing record, even based on generation one and two type equipment. The generation three stuff they're building today is mostly passive safety. The thing I'm talking about, TerraPower, is a generation four design. None have been built, best case 2020. But those are truly passive designs. Those are, we understand heat pipes today. We understand what the decay heat works like. We understand these things a lot better. And so, yes, I do believe that a design that's done now versus a design that's done in the 1960s is night and day.
When you say passive, you don't just mean no human intervention required. Do you mean that even if all the power goes out and all the systems shut down, that it is sort of physically or intrinsically safe?
That's right. In the extreme cases, what you have is the reactor shuts down. They call it a scram. They call it that because in the original thing, they had the control rods are hanging by a string, and the guy would take an axe and cut the rope, and the control rods would fall down. That's where the term scram comes from. Anyway, in the terrible case, the reactor is shut down in a way that it'll never operate ever again. That's in the extreme case where your first three safety systems fail. The last two safety systems that are absolute physically fail-safe are total shutdown things that kill the economic value of the reactor. But you have you don't have any heat situation that can cause a problem. The reason reactors are tough is that even once you shut them down, there's after heat. Now, right when you shut it down, the heat's at a pretty high level. It declines exponentially. And so eventually they can actually take the rods out and put them just in the storage ponds, which initially are in water and then eventually just sitting in dry cask racks because there's so little heat coming out of them. But right at the beginning, you have heat. And if you don't do anything about that heat, then in the case of Chernobyl, you get a graphite fire, no containment vessel, so you're lofting radioactive product up and the wind is blowing it around. In the case of Fukushima, they melted the rods. One of the reactors got to 2,500 degrees C. The other one got to 2,100 degrees C because there was no water. It boiled away the water, and you exposed the fuel. And that's the after heat. You've got to circulate a little bit of water. Now, Generation 3 does it by having AP1000, which is a Westinghouse design, has a big pool of water at the top. And as soon as anything's going down wrong in the reactor, it's heating up, this big pool of water drops down. And that takes care of afterheat for 48 hours. Our equivalent system takes care of afterheat forever.
Where do you think reactors will first be, new generation reactors will first be built, and what technologies do you expect them to use? I mean, we've talked about China, South Africa, India, et cetera, including the United States.
Historically, the United States was the big leader in all these different types of reactors. There's 400 commercial reactors in the world today, 100 of them in the United States, 70 of them in France. So we're the two biggest. China today has 20 that are running, and they have 28 that are under construction. So they're on their way to match and exceed the United States in terms of nuclear reactors. India's on a very aggressive path. Russia's on a fairly aggressive path. And so the idea would be if the United States were the best science and understanding of these new materials, the software, if it could be built here. That may be tricky because the kind of funding for these projects right now isn't high enough. Now, I think it should be, but it may end up being built in another country.
And which technologies do you think are leading now?
Well, the problem in the nuclear industry is nuclear power was invented, and they had this design that worked on a submarine. They very quickly took that and turned it into a power reactor. And so the reactors of the 50s and 60s were basically that sub-design modified. Then they went to Generation 2 and did a fairly good job, but then the industry got shut down between Three Mile Island, Chernobyl, low-cost everything, coal in particular, the industry just disappeared. And so there was almost no innovation. A few companies kept going on these Generation 3 designs, two in particular, Westinghouse with AP1000, and then the French company Areva with what they call the EPR. So those are the two most important Generation 3 designs. And the Chinese are building both of those, and they'll pick one as a standard to finally get some volume on an identical design. There's never been more than five built that are the same. And what the Chinese want to do is build 60 that are the same, of generation 3. Then all these countries are saying, okay, what about generation 4? Is it cheaper? Which we claim we are on paper. We don't have the same waste problem. We don't need fuel like they do because we burn all the uranium. So there's a lot of advantages. There's about 4 or 5 different generation 4 designs, none of which have a commitment by anyone to build them.
And those generation 4 designs include things like the TerraPower 1, Pebble Bed.
There's a ton of these things, and many of them are just kind of cool science, and the economics aren't very attractive. Even generation 3 ended up being more expensive than generation 2. So it's not like we think about in the computer industry where if you have a new generation, it's supposed to be dramatically more powerful and it's supposed to be less expensive. Now, generation 4 can be a lot less expensive. There are ways of doing the design to just make things a lot simpler. That's the proposition. Unless you're getting an environmental benefit from being CO2 free, you're competing with shale gas, which is very prevalent. That's the big revolution in energy of the last decade, is the discovery of natural gas in these new formations, which will be only has really been exploited in the United States, but it's now that's moving globally. And coal is unbelievably cheap. And so you have to compete, unless somebody's giving you credit for not putting out CO2, you've got to compete with those things. And they have much lower capital costs. And they kill people, but they tend to kill only a few at a time, which is highly preferred by politicians.
You described the two classes of energy factories and energy farming. Let's turn to energy farming. Solar, wind, bio, etc. Obviously we need a portfolio of all of them. It's not a matter of, there's not a silver bullet and not really a matter of choosing, but when you look at sort of the technological trajectories of those three industries, solar, wind, and bio, which one do you think has the most potential long-term?
Well, clearly the one with the most potential is solar electric or solar chemical. All of those things are intermittent sources. That is, they're not 24 hours a day whenever you want them. They are only available at certain locations. The wind doesn't blow everywhere. The sun doesn't shine a lot everywhere. You can't grow things everywhere. And some countries have very little of those nice locations. And so these things are hard. In terms of just the raw physics, the amount of energy that's available for solar is phenomenal. And even though it's wildly expensive, wind has to be subsidized by about a factor of 2, solar by about a factor of 5. And that's only when they're just a small percentage of the power. When they get to be any meaningful percentage, that's where the problem of their intermittency becomes overwhelming. And you can actually spend way more to try and solve that problem than you spend on the overpriced stuff to begin with. But solar, it's hard. With wind, you can actually create a lower bound of what it's likely to cost in terms of the materials and things. With solar, you can imagine that it'll get very cheap. Even today, even if they gave you the panels for free, the installation costs make you non-competitive. Yeah. So you have to think, okay, are there going to be robots? Are there going to be scale for these things? But you can dream about solar electric and solar chemical. And as you said, we should pursue them all. I've got investments in dozens of energy companies. The most interesting portfolio is what Vinod Khosla has in his venture fund. It's quite phenomenal. There's a lot of great companies there. But battery companies, solar chemicals, solar thermal, there's a lot of IQ. And that's really, I think, if you want a leading indicator that you can feel good about, the amount of IQ working on energy today and the kind of tools they have to communicate and simulate versus 20 years ago, it's night and day.
Yeah.
And so, but it's very unpredictable whether we're going to get a breakthrough or not. And all three of the problems are serious enough that that uncertainty makes you think, well, why don't we put more into R&D? How do we encourage that? Why don't we do more pilot type things?
Just to refresh us, the three problems are?
Cost, security, and the environment. So other than the fact it's too expensive, you could get cut off at any time, and you're destroying the planet, it's all okay.
How does PV destroy the planet?
No, it doesn't destroy the planet. Just the current way of doing things.
I see.
So. If we don't get the innovation, the breakthrough. But photovoltaic is, its intermittency, I think people deeply underestimate what a huge problem that is if you're trying to design an energy system where PV is more than just a hobby.
Right.
If you're doing PV as your last 3 or 4%, you know, it's nice, it's the sun shines during the day, people turn their air conditioners on during the day, it's nice, you can catch some of that peaking load, particularly if you get enough subsidies and, you know, it's cute. You don't take a photo of your coal plant, you take a photo of your few little panels, and it's nice. But the economics are so, so far from being, in terms of mainstream energy, so far from being appropriate. And that's where subsidies, where do you put the subsidies? Do you put subsidies on R&D, where society always underinvests in basic research? Do you put the subsidies on the deployment? Today, we're putting overwhelmingly 90% of the subsidies are on deployment. This is true in Europe, it's true in the United States, not on the R&D piece. And so unfortunately, you get technologies that no matter how much volume you buy of them, there's no learning curve that takes that stuff and makes it economic. They just buy as much as you want, it's not gonna happen. You need fundamental breakthroughs, which more come out of basic research.
You said they were subsidized at 5x. Do you mean that to be competitive with natural gas-produced electricity, you have to invest, what, $4 for every dollar that you have to? You have basically a tax break or direct subsidy.
Absolutely, yeah.
And
you have a thing called a renewable portfolio standard, where you tell these companies they have to have at least a little bit of the cute stuff, no matter how much they overpay for it, and they mix it into the price. And so you're paying, but it works okay. So say you buy 5% cute stuff, and it's 5 times overpriced, big deal. You know, it only raises your price of electricity a fairly modest amount.
But it doesn't change the overall consumption picture.
Well, the theory was that you get learning curve benefits, but you have to decide, what's the asymptote of any particular technology? If you buy a ton of it, where does it end up? And you know, that's where the politicians get into the mix. And
so we've had sort of three trends in solar. There's the big, you know, utility scale stuff out in the desert. There is the sort of smaller solar installations on sort of, you know, office roofs and, you know, large commercial spaces. And then there's all the way down to the residential. Each one has its own sort of efficiencies and a lack thereof in terms of generation, but large transmission differences about how to get it onto the grid. You know, does the one in the home makes no sense in terms of, you know, the overall energy generation, but might link up with the electric car and sort of some micro generation form as local storage, you know, notions like that. When you look at the big picture, of, you know, where should we be focusing? Should it be massive stuff in the desert, you know, sort of middle-sized stuff on office roofs, or is there a, you know, reinvention to be made at the home?
The if you're going for cuteness, the stuff in the home is the place to go, because it's really kind of cool. You have that little thing on your roof and everything.
Yeah.
If you're interested in the energy problem,
yeah,
it's those big ones in the desert. I mean,
cute is now a pejorative.
Well, the problem is rich countries can afford to overpay for things. We can afford to overpay for medicine. We can overpay for energy. We can rig our food prices. We can overpay for sugar, cotton. It doesn't, you know, our politicians aren't told. that we're suffering because we're overpaying for these things. In the world where most people live, 80%, energy is going to be bought where it's economic so that they can buy cheap fertilizer and grow enough crops to feed themselves, which would be increasingly difficult with climate change effects that they're experiencing. And so to have the rich world, it's great to have the rich world because we're there to think about long-term problems and fund the R&D. The problem is we get sloppy because we're rich, you know, and we're used to saying, oh, you know, let's have this market, you know, the guy who sells cotton get extra money. Let's have the guy who sells sugar get extra money. Ethanol, I mean, has nothing to do with reducing CO2. Mm. It's just sort of a form of farm subsidy, and yet somebody thinks that's energy-related money. And so the rich world is not necessarily the best steward of which solutions are going to work for the world at large. And for the CO2 problem, even if the rich world did very dramatic things, it doesn't come anywhere near to solving the problem. You have to help the rest of the world get energy at a reasonable price in order to have gotten anywhere.
So you've been traveling the world a lot. We'll talk about that in a minute. But when you look at where do you look for a more authentic test of what is the right energy technology? So aside, you know, a place where you don't have the ability to subsidize, a place where rich consumers can't emphasize cute over efficiency, what country do you think is getting this right?
Well, in terms of the innovation IQ and risk-taking and starting up new companies, the United States blows everybody else away. I mean, look at the great energy portfolios and see how much of them are in the United States and how much outside the United States. This is the place where the ideas are. Even our reactor idea, the people who get what we're doing in materials and the simulations and the heat pipes, that expertise is overwhelmingly in the United States. Yes, some in Europe, a little bit in India and China. Mm. Now, we should be willing to deploy anywhere. And when you have an economy that's growing at 9, 10%, which is an energy-intensive economy, say China, versus an economy that's growing at, say, 2% and is getting less energy-intense, if you're in the business, you know, where are the big design wins that count? You better be selling in Asia, particularly to China, because that's where coal, natural gas, wind, solar, any energy thing that's even close to economic, and the Chinese do some subsidization, the biggest demand is going to be there. And so if you believe in scale, that's a market you need to be in. But it's kind of like same with personal computers, which market should go after. You've got to go for global scale for any of these technologies. You don't want to just focus on one market. Now, you want to know which markets are the pioneers. So say you believe in carbon sequestration, that you can take a coal or natural gas plant and pull the CO2 out and put it somewhere. It's too bad there is no country that's doing a good job building pilot plants, trying that out, seeing what the problems with it are. In terms of nuclear, the Russians, the Indians, the Chinese, they are willing to do new and interesting things. Right now, France, Japan, the United States, you'd have to say it's really questionable. There's no immediate appetite for breakthrough nuclear plants to be built. You know, is that a mistake? Well, in the 1950s and the 1960s, we didn't hesitate to do things like that. In the 1970s, Japan. Now China's kind of taken on that mantle of not willing to accept the status quo, doing big new projects.
Earlier when we were talking about solar, and you were de-emphasizing the residential as being largely aesthetic and let's say emotional. Imagine a world where we have made a transition to electric cars, and we do have a smart grid, and storage is distributed on some level. Can you imagine that microgeneration would make more sense in a world where we do have the ability to use possibly electric cars as local storage and have a microgrid sort of model?
No, I mean we should all grow our own food. I mean, we really should.
Well, I live in Berkeley. That's common wisdom there.
But seriously, the energy per square meter you're absorbing. I mean, if you have enough space to energy, you clearly have enough to do food. You should do everything. You should do your waste reprocessing. That scale has some really significant advantages in terms of reliability. Electricity is something you want to be reliable. You know, when the wind blows, you want it to be reliable. When the hail comes, you want it to be reliable. And no, I don't think we're going to turn everybody into a running a little power generation thing. This is dangerous stuff. I mean, for solar to work well, you have to have some very high temperature things going on. Do we want everybody to have that up on the roof? No. But it's just not going to happen.
So suffice to say, we will find no solar cells on the roof of the Gates residence.
Oh, we like to be cute, like everyone. We haven't chosen. And I said rich people can do whatever they want.
Speaking of China, you're just in China. We're just talking about electric cars, et cetera. Transportation is one large source of energy consumption. And you were visiting BYD, which is one of the companies, the Chinese companies that Warren Buffett and others have invested in. What did you learn? What do you think of their approach towards electric cars and batteries in general?
Well, when you see a company like that, it's amazing where they have all the engineers living in a dormitory and working like 16 hours a day. And, you know, they'll point to a piece of land and say, in 9 months, there'll be a car factory there. We went up and saw a car factory that turns out 300,000 cars where there'd been a field 18 months before. And it's incredible to see this speed. You know, they don't talk about permits or, you know, getting their time off for various nice things. And, you know, I've seen that before. When I visited Japan in the 70s, I saw that. When I visited Korea in the 80s, I saw that. It's a certain hard cornice where your quality of your engineering talent is deep and very high, and your bias towards doing hard things is incredible. And so BYD is building great lithium batteries. They're building cars. Actually, a lot of them are gasoline cars, but some electric. Their electric bus is a phenomenal product, because doing an electric bus is very hard. The amount of torquing you have to get when the bus is at a standstill, or particularly if it's sitting in a depressed area. And they've solved a lot of very interesting engineering problems. And they're just working day and night on those things. So they, the same way that a Matsushita or a Samsung made huge contributions in engineering things, now there's a wave of Chinese companies, where I'd put BYD kind of the top of the list, that are in that magic time period. And you look at them and you think, why are you doing so many products? Well, they have so many darn engineers. And 70% of those products will never come out. Some of their ideas are overly ambitious, but that's okay. You know, if you have all those engineers and you have some process for filtering out the ones that work and don't work. And so they're great. They are not yet the best lithium battery guys, but they're close to being it. You know, in the next 5 years, they may take the great work that was done in Japan and Korea and go beyond it.
There is a school of thought that looks at the sort of the big industrial and big industries in creation and tries to ensure the United States has a role to play. What semiconductors was in the 80s and the 90s and our fears about U.S. competitiveness, you now hear echoed with batteries. Lithium and other batteries are the sort of great 21st century technology. China is not coming from a position of weakness. In many ways, they have advantages. Those Korean plants, those Koreans that you described, many of those plants are in fact in China. China's made it a priority in a way the United States hasn't. Do you, when you look at the sort of, you know, the role of batteries in both in terms of technologies and country competitiveness, do you think that that the United States can, in fact, compete with China?
Well, there's two ways to compete. One is to take the current technology, lithium technology, invented by a guy at University of Texas, and have the government throw money at the most politically favored guy in the country to go build a Me Too battery factory. And there are billions of dollars that have been assigned to that waste. The other is to actually back people who have better battery ideas.
Yeah.
And again, if you take innovative battery companies, overwhelmingly, they're here in the United States. There's several that Vinod's backed. There's people like Professor Sadoway up at MIT that I backed directly. There's a lot of very interesting battery concepts. Now, batteries are hard to do. And when we think of batteries, you have to think of two types of batteries. One is a battery for a car. And it has to be light, and it has to be crash-proof. But the total amount of energy it has to store is not all that large. And that you could convert cars from gasoline to the grid. Now, that doesn't give you an environmental benefit unless your grid is somehow changed. But it, at least it gives you a security benefit because the you're sourcing your coal for your grid locally. So that's advantageous. The hard battery problem is the grid battery problem, where if you're getting, say, 50% of your energy from solar and the sun only shines during the day, then you have to be storing enough energy for the night. And you have two-week periods in the desert where you get no sun at all. So you have to be storing energy for that time frame as well. And that is a mind-blowing problem. I mean, that's a factor of 100 more demanding than any battery technology that we have today.
And is that a battery problem, or are there other ways to store that?
Well, the word battery often is restricted to chemical type storage.
Yeah.
And so there are these supercapacitor type approaches where you're using other physics phenomena to store the things that only in the broad sense of anything that stores energy can be called a battery, or are they batteries. You know, Volta wouldn't recognize it.
Just back on the traditional lithium ones, when you look at again the national competitiveness one, lithium the element is pretty broadly available. No one country, I presume, can monopolize that. You have technology, which you described, and you say we're doing pretty well if we invest in the right people. What about labor, land, manufacturing? Just what it takes to turn the element into a battery. Can we compete as a country there?
Well, there's a lot of manufacturing things that we're not competing in, and the degree to which you ought to try and take government money, essentially away from the things we are good at competing with and try and funnel them into some part of the things we're not good at competing with and say, well, these are politicians, and so they'll get that right. You know, markets will screw this up, and so let's get them, to move money from one thing to the other. Will they give it to the right people in the right way, or will they just create distortion? I think it's hard. It is disappointing when you see all this innovative work in the United States that so many cases you don't choose to actually do the manufacturing here. Because the broad-based benefit to people of all educational levels somewhat presupposed that you would do all those functions in the United States. So I'm concerned about that, but I'm also concerned about anything that would try and come in and change that. The very best author on energy, Václav Smil, actually the book he's writing now is about how America could come back and get a manufacturing base. And there's a lot of people who think that's fairly important. One element that's greatly underestimated because people cried wolf on it too early, and so it's considered strange to make a big deal about it now, but it is robotics. There are ways to take the labor issues and make those far, far less important. And so it'd be great, but when it comes to batteries, we always have to decide when we're talking about innovation, are we trying to innovate for all humans or just the ones that live on this particular piece of real estate? When I think about the environment, I think, hey, I don't care if if the guy who invents it is from some strange country, and as long as they can make it in such a way that we all get to use it,
yeah,
and it's environmentally sound, I don't really care that much where it's made. And so that's where you get this, is it about nationalism or is it about environmentalism? And you know, what's the, and we end up with things like the ethanol thing, or we end up with things like subsidizing things that don't scale.
So as an investor, you put the environment ahead of nationalism in your choices?
Well, any company that wants to be in these markets better have a view that they're going to sell their product to the United States and China and any other place. That's the right thing to do. So you're going to see a lot of companies that are based on U.S. innovation, and I wish they would put more manufacturing in the U.S., but some of that probably won't end up here.
I mean, about after this next question, I'll open up to the audience for questions. So prepare yours. You mentioned the notion of energy farming, and of course the most explicit form of that is biofuels. You've been talking a lot about ethanol, but you have some investments in biofuels that are obviously more promising. Can you describe a little what you think is a positive future for biofuels?
Yeah, with biofuels, you always have to decide which kind of land you're using. There's the land that's good enough to grow crops today. Mm. There's the land that's good enough to grow grass and be used for grazing today. And then there's either water bodies or land that's not being used for anything today. And if you get into using that first class of land, then you're competing with growing food. And so you're actually spiking food prices by taking this energy demand and moving it in there.
The corn being the best example.
Yeah, for rich people, this is okay. For poor people, this is a real problem because their food budget is an extremely high percentage of their income. And so you have people who are driven from having adequate food to not having adequate food as we're pushing these things up. So the hopeful approach is not to use that land that's both expensive and has high opportunity costs, either through intercropping or using residues that aren't used in food chain today, or getting onto the other types of land. That's where the most interesting biofuel stuff is. But again, biofuels is hard because it's farming.
What's intercropping?
Intercropping means you're using a period of time during the annual calendar where the food guys have chosen to leave the land fallow. And if you're intercropping, particularly with something that's leguminous, that's actually restoring nitrogenous compounds to the soil, then you're actually beneficial, like you grow alfalfa or soybeans in those periods. So it's taking the year-long calendar and exploiting holes in it.
And which particular technologies or plant types do you think satisfy this criteria of, you know, getting those things right?
I'd say biofuels were not quite clear. There's a ton of algae stuff, which I'm invested in a number, and there's just a ton. And the number of ways of doing things with algae is pretty amazing. That's pretty hard. Some people do that in ponds. Some people actually try and do it in the ocean. Then there's various grasses, which miscanthus is this very fast-growing grass. And so if you could somehow process that in the right way. And then there's just people trying to take the cellulosic part of crop residues and come up with a processing technique where you go from cellulose into biofuels in a fairly expensive way. And there's four different ways to do that, none of which are all that economic.
This is the thing like the corn stalks and, you know, other waste material.
Right. So how do you process? But this is a chemical processing question. How do you take what's basically a cellulose input and make a hydrocarbon? So there's things that involve catalytic converters at high temperature. There's things that involve acid processing. It's a chemistry problem. Unfortunately, still fairly expensive. Now, there's a few companies that claim they have these magic enzymes, and the enzymes don't get used up. So it's possible you'll get some advances there. And there are many sources of cellulose. If you can start with that as your feedstock, then the economics start to work. Now, before you start substituting for oil, the numbers, the amount of land mass that you have to use is pretty unbelievable. You can get some rounding error stuff by taking your garbage and cutting up some wood and taking those corn stalks, but that doesn't add up to much. You really have to take greenfield territory and start to grow something to get up and measurably impact, say, U.S. oil importation.
Got it. I'll take questions now from the audience. Boy, it's a little hard to hear, to see. Let me start over here with this gentleman, and then I'll move over to that side.
Right here?
Yes.
Yeah, thanks. You talked a lot about economic energy generation and technology for that, but can you address the technology that's being used to increase efficiency of energy usage, maybe through home energy management, smart grid techniques, that kind of thing?
Yeah, there's certainly big room for efficiency, but when we go after efficiency, we have to think of what goal are we aiming for. One is just purely economic, and that's fantastic. The second is to say, can we, by increasing efficiency, deal with our climate problem? And the answer there is basically no, because the climate problem requires more than a 90% reduction in CO2 emitted, and no amount of efficiency improvement is going to, every year we're improving your efficiency, enough poor people are increasing their energy intensity so that you're not ever going to get the amount of CO2 emitted to go down unless you deal with the one magic factor, which is CO2 per kilowatt hour. You have to get it on the generation side because the growth in demand will match efficiency. In some realms, heating buildings, particularly new design buildings, and lighting, some air conditioning things, there's amazing efficiency stuff that can be done. Lighting's the killer because you're mostly making heat with today's light bulbs, and so the prices of the LED-based solutions are going to be fantastic. Unfortunately, it's a fairly small part of the energy equation. There's a lot of energy consumption, like the way we make fertilizer today. It's an unbelievably optimized process, and there is no way you're going to get more than 10% improvement in how much energy it takes to make a certain amount of fertilizer. And so fairly quickly you get down to the ones where there's not the same room for improvement, which is largely industrial processes. So we should do the efficiency stuff. It's a great thing. It has economic benefits. But we shouldn't think of that as making that big of a dent in the environmental challenge.
I'm actually going to take a question from the online audience on Twitter and then come over there. One of the questions that came in is, you mentioned earlier about the advantages of robotic manufacturing. And obviously, this leads to questions about employment and and where the next source of jobs will be. Do you feel that, the questioner asked, do you feel that the young people are preparing for the careers that will be left when more and more manufacturing becomes robotic?
Well, depending on where you are in the education, how much education you get, yes, if you're a college graduate, then it's fantastic. The number of blue-collar jobs has been going down and will continue to go down. Mm. Manufacturing automation, even though it hasn't meant robots that kind of move around and do things, that's the biggest form of efficiency. And people have a tendency to think of it as mostly offshoring. Yes, that's a phenomena. But even the Chinese, the increase in the manufacturing jobs in China is not that big. Mm. They're looking at the service sector as the primary job creator, although they're hoping their manufacturing can stay stable.
The question over here. The gentleman, do we have the microphone? I believe there was. Okay, I'll take the gentleman in the third row, please.
Thank you. With all the talk about nuclear energy, one thing that we didn't talk about is the spent fuel. It seems like the current process for disposing spent fuel is to bury it in the earth. Is that a sustainable practice? And what are the long-term effects of that?
Yeah, the current reactors generate a certain amount of waste. Now, compared to the waste that a coal plant generates, it's tiny, but it's radioactive, and so you really want to make sure that nobody's near it. It's the entire U.S., if the entire U.S. was powered, used nuclear power to do everything, you could come up with one waste repository that would hold hundreds of years. And let's say you came up with a waste repository that worked for, say, you knew it worked for 1,000 years, and it was designed so that after 1,000 years you could go in and take it, move it somewhere else. The question is, will we be richer 50 years from now, 100 years from now, 200 years from now, 400 years from now, 800 years from now? Will we have understand how to simulate earthquakes, and will we just be well off enough that as long as we do a great job for this minuscule storage area, that you know we've highlighted it, they know it's there, that you know we're sure it's safe for thousands of years, and then you know they take care of that. Is that satisfactory or not? The nuclear reactor that TerraPower believes in generates 1/1000th as much waste as a typical nuclear reactor, because we just burn and burn and burn. We burn everything. And so this is one of our big advantages, is you don't run out of uranium because we burn the stuff that's the 99.3% of uranium, not just the stuff that's the 0.7%. There's two isotopes in there, and everyone else just burns the fissile stuff. So I do think waste is a problem, but I wouldn't say that the non-TerraPower designs, it actually should be the thing that blocks them from being used. It's a very solvable problem. You know, Yucca Mountain was a reasonable solution, and then you know the federal government ended up not being that consistent on the issue, and they put together a blue ribbon panel. I don't think that's the thing that'll hold it back. I think much more perceptions of safety and the true economics are where nuclear has something to prove. But it doesn't have a storage problem, and it's not a farming-type technology, so the other technologies, they also have something to prove.
I'll let the last question go to Twitter. It's about hydrogen. Hydrogen as a fuel is obviously attractive because obviously you'd use seawater, et cetera, but storage, et cetera, has been a challenge. What are your thoughts about a hydrogen fuel source and an economy increasingly built on that?
Well, I've never understood that. You have to get energy from somewhere, and that's what coal, natural gas, and nuclear are all about. That's where you get the energy from, or the sun. The sun growing crops, the sun heating things up, the sun giving you photons. Hydrogen is just a chemical, and it's a really nice chemical that is per mass. The amount of energy you can get from it is very large, but all of our applications are per volume type applications. And so you have to say, well, what is going to be stored in? It turns out it's fairly flammable. It's a hydrogen fire is really something, because there's no big red flame or anything. I mean, it's very, very, very hot, but it's invisible. And you really don't want to mess with hydrogen all that much. And it's hard to convert the entire system. We use hydrocarbons today. So almost any process that could generate hydrogen, you could take and generate hydrocarbons out of it. And hydrocarbons have this nice thing in terms of volume storage. They are liquid. You know, once you get up to about five carbons, they are liquid. And we've got pipes that we move them around in. And so hydrogen was never a solution to anything. It's just a potential way to store energy. But it turns out it's a very hard way to store energy. So if it has a role at all, it's pretty minor, because the hard problems are, where did it come from?
Well, the notion presumably was that you would use your farms, your PV, your wind, et cetera, to store the generate the energy, convert to hydrogen, store the hydrogen, liquefy it, put it through a pipeline, and then you know get over that kind of intermittent.
You're not going to liquefy hydrogen. You if you want to liquefy something, make a hydrocarbon. Hydrogen's only liquid at extremely low temperatures, so you're going to be wasting. You're going to have some of the most fragile infrastructure in the world. So, unless there's some huge breakthrough, about how to store this stuff, which it's great. There are crazy guys who have ideas about anything, including this. But I'd say it's very, very unlikely, and it doesn't solve the hard problems. If you can take sunlight and make hydrogen, I'll show you a simple trivial reaction to take your hydrogen and make a hydrocarbon. And then that hydrocarbon can just go into a normal pipeline, it can go into a normal car, it can work in a great way. So, you know, in that one brief moment,
yeah,
you will have hydrogen, but you won't use it as the primary energy store.
Terrific. We've run out of time. Please join me in thanking Bill Gates.
Great. Good job.
Thank you.